house of the Lord, I'll never get tired of saying that.
Amen.
Because it does matter. It does matter who your alliance is to. And to be aligned with God. To know that God is on your side. To know that God is for you. One of my absolutely favorite psalms that got me through a lot and was Psalm 56 and verse 9. And this comes out of the Amplified Version. And it says, "Then shall my enemies turn back in the day that I cry out. This I know, for God is for me."
Yes.
That is so powerful. When we think about, you know, we've been talking about favor, you know, having favor and having God to know that he works on your behalf. How powerful is that? Absolutely powerful to know that God is on your side. You know, one of the things we look at, you know, we looked at David when he took on Goliath. Now, if you look from a technical standpoint, the one who should have took on Goliath was Saul. Because Saul was head and shoulders above everybody, you know, and Saul was the leader of the army, but, you know, he was afraid. Now, you can imagine, you know, somebody as big as Goliath and he's crying out. But David understood one thing. David wasn't going in his own power. He was going in the might of the Lord. There was a big difference. David wasn't trained to fight. You know, we was thinking about coming over here, how many times that, you know, God puts us on our heart to do something, you know, and it's like right away, here come the excuses.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I can't do this. You know, I'm not this or that, and I don't have the education. I can't do any of this. Well, I had a student come back today, and it's always good when they may have struggled, but they keep going and they persevere and they get their license. And I was in the truck and he come and said, "I got my license today." Well, I really appreciate that. You know why? Because you never gave up. That's a lot of the difference right there in people. I've seen through the years, if people would just keep pressing on, how much their life would change. If they keep believing God and keep praying. In 2 Chronicles 16:9, and this is out of the New American Standard, and this is a popular verse, "For the eyes of the Lord move to and fro throughout the earth, that he may strongly support those whose heart is completely his." That's the first part of that verse. And just remember that. His eyes run to and fro throughout the earth, that he may strongly support those whose heart is completely his. That's what it takes. It takes dedication. One of my favorite songs, and I like to share some of the verses that come out of the Bible, because the basics of it comes out of the Bible, some of the background of it, and then people write lyrics because something has touched their life. And one of my songs that I really love, and I remember hearing this in a movie years ago, but today when I was going to be doing this, and the song is "Oh How He Loves You and Me." That's just something that just got my heart. Oh how he loves you and me. And I'm going to go through some of this. Oh how he loves you and me. Oh how he loves you and me. He gave his life. What more could he give? Oh how he loves you. Oh how he loves you and me. Think about that. Just get that in your soul, because you know what? We come to this point in our life that it's time for us to really decide whose side we're on.
Yeah.
It comes to that decision time in our life that sometimes you are faced with that. Do you believe or do you not believe?
Right.
Who are you standing for? You know, because I love those Christians when somebody asks them, "Do you believe in Jesus Christ?" And I mean, it comes right out. It comes out. You bet I do. Yeah. You know I believe in Jesus Christ. And you know what? I tell you what, those people that's willing to stand up in the face of adversity.
Yeah.
Well, let's take a look at Daniel. You know, when Daniel's thrown in the lion's den, and you think about that. You know? I mean, can you imagine that? Because the lions, I've seen lions. When, you know, you go to the zoo. And I remember the old zoo, when they Blank Park Zoo. They had the gibbon, the monkeys, that used to be right beside the lion's cage.
Yeah.
Okay, the lions were been a big open area, but these gibbons were, there was just a fence up there. And you know, gibbons are the monkeys with the long arms. Well, it always cracked me up because I'm sitting there watching these gibbons and they're hanging on the fence and they're just doing this toward these lions, you know. Just come on, you know. And I'm thinking, buddy, if that fence falls down, I know what they're having for lunch, you know. Because you're going to be their lunch. But they're just sitting there just aggravated. And them lions, good thing they must have ate because they was just kind of sitting there, you know. And it was like they just kind of ignored them. And every time I get that picture of Daniel, Daniel was praying. Daniel was a praying man. You can throw me in the lion's den. Because you know what? No matter what happened, he was trusting God to protect him. And God shut the lion's mouth.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
And then people, you know, you get people who say, well, they wasn't really hungry, Tim. That's the reason. Well, it's funny. When the ones that decide to put, you know, in the lion's den, okay, they got thrown in, right? Their family. And before they got to the bottom, the lion snapped them up.
Yep.
So why was they hungry at that point?
Right?
God shut them. It's the same thing. Look through the Bible. That's why I love that verse, for God is for me, because so many times in the Bible, he's proven that over and over.
Yep.
The three Hebrew boys thrown in the fire. Think about that. They, when they was thrown in the fire, they was bound up, and he threw them in the fire. No, Nebuchadnezzar, you know, they look, and it the guys that threw them in, they got burned up. They got killed.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, Nebuchadnezzar, look at, wait a minute, there's something strange. They fell down and they was loose and they was walking around in the fire. The fiery furnace was heated up 7 times more than it was even made to be heated. Is that right?
Right.
And they threw them in, they got killed. And all of a sudden, wait, there's something wrong here. Wait a minute. I thought we threw 3 in, but there's one in there with them that's looked like the Son of God. Wait a minute. And they're walking around. They're no more. What's going on here? There's something here because God stood up for them. Because he said, are you going to worship, you know, the whole scenario where you're going to worship the statue? No, we don't even have to answer you.
Yep.
Because we know if God delivers us in the fire, out of fire, don't matter, we're not going to worship your statue.
Right.
Well, I'm telling you what, you talk about somebody red-faced and all upset, throw them in the furnace. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Either way, I'm still going to be with my maker either way. And they fell down. I love that. They was bound up. You know, they fell down, they bound up, and they was loose, walking around.
Yeah.
And they pulled them out of there. And the thing is, if you ever been around fire, they didn't even smell like smoke.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Okay? They didn't even smell like it. You know that? And the clothes wasn't singed, hair wasn't singed. Okay, but God was going to show himself, just like he says, he's going to show himself mighty.
Right.
And in your life, he's probably done that same thing. Uh-huh. When you looked at a situation, and you know, that's what I love. When you know it's God and nobody else could have worked that out.
Right.
Nobody else could have gave you, you know, all of a sudden somebody agrees to pay for your education.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I always look back on my life is in my sophomore year in college, I wasn't able to finish. Dad was just too sick to go on and I had to work and I couldn't do finish my education like I wanted to. That always seemed like a disappointment to me because I wasn't able to do it, but the family came first. I understood that. He had supplied all the needs as I was growing up. Now it was my turn.
Mm-hmm.
But it's ironic, isn't it? I didn't get bitter about it. It's just something that didn't happen. I'd love to finish. But then, all these years later, now I'm teaching for this college.
Yeah.
You know, isn't that something?
Yes.
And basically, anytime I want to take classes, I can take classes as many as I want now.
Cool.
Isn't that something? How God honored that. All those years later. And you know the one thing about it? It's time for us to really get serious and realize God is for every one of you.
Yes.
He wants the best for your life.
Yes.
You know, and that's why I know I say it a lot, but I deal with students and I deal with situations that sometimes they don't have anybody that believes in them.
Mm-hmm.
Not anybody. I think it's so sad. You know, when from the time they're little, they well, you'll never amount to nothing. You'll never amount. We should never say that to anybody. You don't know the plans that God has for that person's life.
Right, right.
And there's a reason we are put on this earth.
Yes.
It doesn't make any difference what your situation is or where your background is. One thing, I've been fortunate enough to be a trucker for 40 years now, you know, and I can identify with truckers, so I can touch people that go around that circle. I understand. Y'all got jobs, and you go around people that you can understand. You know, there's something about saying, you know what, I know how you feel. I've been there. See, that's what Jesus did when he became a man. See, then people can't use that excuse. Well, God doesn't really know because God was never a man. Yes, he was.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
You know, Jesus cried. You know, Jesus wept, as the scripture says. He understands how it feels to be rejected. He understands when the family, you know, they had some issues with him. The brothers, they didn't really look, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on in the family, and they didn't really accept him the way they should have, but later on, they understood.
Amen.
You know, and there's a lot of things that Mary, the mother, saw, but I love what Mary did, and that's what we should all do. She pondered a lot of stuff in her heart.
Yes.
You know, she didn't say it wasn't so, she just didn't understand it all. But I love that she pondered in the heart. And sometimes God will put things on you. I want you to do this. And rather than say, no, Lord, I just can't, why don't we ponder in the heart? And, you know, we're going to keep praying over that. And you know what, Lord? You know what? Get to that point where when the Lord says, let's do it, let's do it.
Yeah.
We had an opportunity. We was coming back from Southeast Iowa to meet my older pastor from the church that I had went to in Southeast Iowa, and we was talking about being obedient, and it was so great a conversation, because the one thing about obedience, when God asks you to do something, let's just do it.
Yeah.
You know, let's just do it. Not make excuses. You know, and say, hey God, okay. You know why? When we sing that song, you know, have thine own way. You know, we sang that song sometime in church. A pastor told me once, you should not sing that song unless you believe.
Amen.
Don't be singing idle words. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. And we used to sing that song, Soul Say Yes, you know? Soul Say Yes. And we sang that last one. I used to be in the worship team, and, you know, I surrender all. That's another one.
Yeah.
Okay?
Amen.
They said, don't sing that either. Unless you really mean, I surrender all. And that means giving every area of your life to God. I remember being out in Springfield, Virginia, on a truck, and I went to a church on a Saturday night, and they had a testimony service, and they had singing, and this one lady got up, and she testified, and he said, the way that I really got my life right with God was letting him go into every room of my heart. Sometimes we don't want him to go in certain rooms, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord, I don't know, man. That's pretty scary. We got it boarded up, got cobwebs and everything in there. We don't want to let anybody in those darkest secrets of our life. But you know what God wants? He wants to go in there so he can clean it out.
Come on.
We don't need to have resentment for stuff that happened 20, 30 years ago.
Right.
I'm telling you, some people can hold on to bitterness a long time. They can carry it to the grave. Why would you want to do that? Something that happened years ago.
Right.
You know, we serve a God that's moving forward, you know? And he said, forgetting those things behind and reaching forth, that's what God wants us to do. He's a present help right now.
Yeah.
He's a right now God.
Mm-hmm.
And as tonight, as we go and open this prayer time and sharing time, just remember the last part of Psalm 56, verse 9, this I know. I love that. This I know. It's like I'm certain. Paul said to know him, to know him. This I know. You know, there's some things you know. So I've been driving a truck a long time, and I know that there's certain ways I can turn a corner and certain ways it ain't work.
Right.
You know, that's one thing experiences teach you. You know, no matter what field you are, experience teach you what works and what doesn't work. That's what it teaches you. It doesn't make you an expert, but it tells you that. Okay? And this is God is saying right here. This I know. This I know. I love it. Because David understood. This I know, for God is for me.
Yes, Lord.
He made it personal.
Yes, Lord.
That's what God, it's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ that makes all the difference. That's what changes people's life. You know, it's time for us to really stop. Sometimes I can speak for, you know, sometimes we complain so much about this. I don't have this. I don't have this. It's really time to stop complaining and start proclaiming how good God is. That's when lives change. I've seen it, you know, and stop, you know, sometimes we get people, some people are so critical. You know, it's time to stop criticizing and start evangelizing, you know, because that's what changes people's lives. God did that for you, Tim. Can he do it for me? Yes, because he's not a respecter of persons.
Amen.
You know, he died for all of us. We had to decide to accept it or not, but he died for every one of us. It wasn't just this person over here and that person. It's every one of us. Are we ready to surrender all?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Lord.
Hallelujah.
Lord.
Hallelujah. We're going to open this time up. We appreciate everybody prayed for us. We've gone on a trip and you know, to see your grandchildren, to spend time with them is so precious, you know. 4 years old, and they, you know, they just seem like we took a big picture. We didn't even have them all in the picture, but there's so many.
Yeah.
Some of them wasn't there, but to see them grow up and be able to hold them and, you know, be able to see them so precious and the sons and we definitely just appreciate that because family is what's about.
Yeah.
You ever wonder why God created us? Somebody asked me one time, did God create us because he was lonely? Well, I don't know if he was lonely or not in that sense. But do you ever notice we were created in what? His image.
Right.
Isn't that something?
Amen.
We created his image. We had two arms.
Glory.
We can reach out and hug.
Yes.
We can reach out and hug each other. Isn't that something?
Amen.
We got a tongue. We can praise him.
Yes.
You know, talk in general. We got two ears. We can hear him. We can see him. We can feel him in his image. I love that, you know. And to think, it all started in the beginning. And in Revelations, Jesus said in the beginning and the ending, the Bible frames itself. One person said, all we need to do is stay in the middle. Like bookends.
Yes.
We're going to be all right.
Amen.
So we're going to go ahead and open this time up.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Right.
On people and what you're talking about. I heard someone say, you know, people don't care what you know until they know you care.
That's right.
So,
that's cool.
You know, at times, you know, religious people have had the tendency to kind of browbeat people, you know, make them feel insignificant or bad or whatever. And I think when we do that, or when people do that, they miss the opportunity to share the love of God.
That's right. That's right.
If I didn't care, I wouldn't say anything. I wouldn't care what happened to you. You know,
right.
Go your own way or whatever. But I think it goes to what you're saying when we talk about people you're never going to amount to anything. You know, you're worthless. And, you know, your past doesn't determine your future.
That's right.
That's not necessarily true. It can't be, or none of us would be here today.
That's right.
Right.
That's right. And some people are locked in that. You know, their past. Well, Tim, this happened to me. You know, sometimes it's time to move on.
That's right.
Okay? It's not the time when our sins are gets hurled. I love what scripture, because the one trans talks about it's hurled. It's like everything is just kind of wrapped up and hurled. It's thrown into the sea, never to be thought of again. That's what I love about Jesus, where you don't get thrown. Some people you haven't seen, and they still bring up stuff that happened years ago.
Yeah, we're supposed to be walking with the Lord.
Yeah.
Just by definition, that's a progression.
That's right. That's right.
You know, we're not just ramble around wandering. We're actually on the road to a specific location or to a specific place where our lives can be determined, where they are going to be what God has predetermined them to be, you know, if we keep walking with him.
That's right.
So, yeah, I mean, just the very metaphor that we use for Christianity is a walk with God.
That's it.
It's telling us that it is a leaving those things which are behind.
Right.
Moving on, pressing on toward the mark.
That's right.
Calling of God.
That's
yes.
it. Come follow me.
Yes.
Isn't that something?
Amen.
That means Jesus walking in front of me. If you're supposed to follow him, he said, come follow me.
Yeah.
not he's not talking, he's not religion, you know, or self-help programs.
You're right.
He said, come follow me.
Yes.
So important. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, prayer. That's what the church is here for.
Yeah.
To pray for that. Yes, Sal.
Yeah, we'll pray for Dan, Tammy, and him have spent the last 2 days at the VA. They go back again tomorrow. They just need to get some answers.
Amen.
He needs healing desperately.
Dan, okay. Okay. We'll definitely do that. Mike.
Cindy, her breathing is improving. Respiratory and everything seem to be coming back up to where they need to be. She had some oral surgery before Christmas and stuff, and things are supposed to be settling down, and they were not healing like they were supposed to stuff, and she had a relapse, apparently a bone fragment or whatever was embedded, and started surfacing and stuff, and apparently it's up against the nerve, so she has to go back in. She was wanting to be here tonight, but she's home, and her side of her face is partially swollen and stuff, so just pray for the healing to take its place. Right now, in the name of the Lord.
Amen. Yeah, but definitely. Yes.
I had a wonderful revelation. Back 2015 when I died, you know, I had the nurses come out and took out the car, and they had me up here like this. And afterwards they even said, why is he so light? And immediately I my mind went to, he shall give his angels charge over thee and keep thee in all thy ways. Well, who was that angel? Who were those angels? And the Lord showed me it was them that picked me up. I mean, they were like angels.
Yeah.
There you go.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
You know, careful what you do. I mean, you could be an angel to somebody.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Yeah, that is so true. That's true.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you,
Lord. That is so absolutely so true. Yes, Ron.
Things in her past, just like you mentioned, and we need to, you know, take them before the Lord and leave them there.
That's right.
It's more peace than we need. We can have it if we just ask for it and receive it.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, I just want to thank the Lord for his word being released through brothers and sisters on Sunday, and then them even coming into being, those words even coming into being, even at the beginning of the service before, when Pastor started praying and stuff, like the Holy Spirit moving in here so heavily. I just thank the Lord for the people that were here and that are here that were sensitive to the Lord, and just everything just linked together. It was a beautiful time, and I saw the love of the Lord just shining through this place, and as it was even said, that this is just the beginning of what He wants to do here, and I thank the Lord for that, and just give Him praise.
Amen.
That's absolutely, I'm always awed when you have, God moving in people's lives. And that, that's really what He wants to do. We talk about just the favor means gaining approval, acceptance, special benefits, or blessings.
Yeah.
Think about what God has done for you and what He wants to do. There's so much more He wants to do in your life, and wants to do in the family of God. And He wants to use all of us.
Yes.
I always think about when in Luke 1:30, when the angel said to her, this Mary, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God."
Yeah.
I mean, can you imagine? Now take that message. And God's not a respecter of persons.
Right.
But can you imagine Gabriel, who's before God and comes down and deliver this message to Mary? I mean, how powerful was that to come down? But He delivers messages to us a lot.
Yes,
that's what His word is.
Amen.
You hear those words and it comes in your heart. He impresses things in your heart. But one of the things He's so often to us, if we could just hear that, He loves us with an everlasting love.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I love you. You are my child.
Yes.
And how precious that. I was downtown today, driving with students, and this lady she had a couple of kids, and one was on the ground, but the other one, she had one wrapped around her chest. This little, just wasn't very old, but was wrapped around. And I just thought how secure that baby was.
Mm-hmm.
And it just something touched me. That baby was just wrapped around, mm-hmm. close to the mom's heart.
Yeah,
And I thought, that's where God has us.
Yes.
That's how powerful. And we need to never forget that. That's one thing we tend to forget when we go through things. Well, God walked away, or God, no, this is where God has you.
Right.
Don't ever forget that, please.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. All right. Well, let's go ahead and stand up and pray. Oh, hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for being here tonight. We thank you that you have given us favor and have blessed us, and you love us with that everlasting love. This we know, that you are for us. You are for us. If God be for us, who can be against us? We are on the right side. Hallelujah. We are on the winning side. Hallelujah. All Creator loves us. Let us never forget that. Lord, with Norma, the heart issue, Lord, you're more than able. You are the healer. Hallelujah. You are the Lord that healeth. You can heal us. You can turn any situation around. We ask you to be with Tammy and Dan at the VA hospital in that situation. Cindy with their breathing, and Ron's wife, Lord, the blood pressure and the EKG and all of those situations, Lord, and dealing with all those things, you are more than able. The Bible said, is there anything too hard for God? And the Bible says, for with God, all things are possible. It doesn't say some things. It doesn't say a few things. It might be something. It's so, for with God, all things possible. Lord, let's never forget that. Oh, Father God, we just want to tell you tonight, yes, we surrender all to you. Let us not hold anything in our life back. Oh, you're looking to and fro to show yourself strong for those that love you. Lord, let's never forget you. Mighty Counselor, Mighty God, our wonderful Father. You are more than able to move in all these situations. And we thank you for answered prayer. We thank you for your prayers you answered in the past, the ones you are answering right now, and the ones you're going to answer in the future. We thank you for that. Lord, we praise you tonight. We lift you up tonight because you are God. You are God above all gods. And it's all about you. And we want to praise you and give you the glory. In your wonderful holy name, we pray, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Okay. Please turn off your phone. Thank you. This Friday, Eastern Gate House of Prayer, 7 p.m., so all who can join us.
Amen. We're in starting blocks for the year. I know the Lord wants to reveal things to his people to get us aligned up for what's coming this year. He has purposes and plans for this specific body, but also wants us to reach out to this region, this neighborhood, this city. We will have a time of intercession, prayer, worship. We will also pray for individuals that come, laying on the hands, just time of fellowship. We will also have communion, just to celebrate the love of the Lord and just doing in remembrance of him and his presence and his victory that we now get the joy of walking in. So.
Hallelujah.
Praise
the Lord. Great. Praise the Lord. Okay, let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again? That your people may rejoice in you. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body function to the perfection which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. And Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Ron, would you be so kind to come and take our offering tonight?
Church.
Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, we love you tonight. Thank you, Lord, for your presence. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, for your favor, for your grace. We bless you tonight, Lord. You're worthy of all of our praise and all of our worship. And we thank you, Lord, that you inhabit the praises of your people. We thank you, Lord, that even more you inhabit us. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for making us the point where heaven and earth collide. Thank you, Jesus, for the privilege of knowing you and trusting you. For every good and perfect gift we know comes from you. For you are a good God, God of love, mercy, and grace. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand tonight. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Mike and James. Thank you, Tim. Great job as always. Appreciate it. Thank all of you for sharing your prayer requests and testimonies. Let's just believe now that it is finished. Amen. Whatever your request was, God has moved. Amen. We just need to celebrate the victory. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'll be brief tonight. Praise the Lord, and get on home before the cars freeze up. Praise the Lord. Could be worse. We could be Amish, or Amish, or whatever. We could be riding home in a buggy tonight. Praise the Lord. Ooh, talk about chilly. I don't know. This is like a three-dog night if I ever heard of one. You'd have three dogs and maybe a horse to wrap and curl up with or something to keep you warm on the way home anyhow.
It's been done before.
It certainly has. Praise the Lord, but thank God not by me. Nor will it if there's anything I can do to help it. Praise God. Thank the Lord for modern conveniences and all the blessings that go with it. Praise the Lord. Some of it's a hassle, but I'm glad I don't have to build a fire every night. Mike, praise the Lord. I know he does. He does that wood burning, but I'm glad I'm not chopping wood every day and hauling water and walking. We used to go stay with my grandparents. They never had indoor plumbing, nor did they, or an inside toilet. The outhouse was way at the back of the property, probably an acre of ground between the house and it. Man, I mean, and they lived up in northern Iowa, right up on the Minnesota border, up around Spirit Lake, north of Spirit Lake a little bit, little tiny town. Well, when we were there in the wintertime, I'll tell you, unless you really had to go to the bathroom, you didn't go till morning. I mean, you waited, because it was a long walk out there through the cold. I'll tell you, nothing like a Sears catalog to work with in the middle of the night, man. So, praise the Lord. God bless our ancestors. Hallelujah. And thank the Lord that we're living a little bit better than they. Hallelujah. But, amen. They were good people, and it was the norm then. I mean, I'm talking about in the early 50s, and you get out away from the cities. A lot of places, just that's the way it was. Praise the Lord. So it's all good. Amen. All right, let's get right into this. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 16. Colossians 2, verse 16. God bless everybody being here tonight. Cold night, but it's warm in the Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, Colossians chapter 2, verse 16, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or of the new moon or of the Sabbath days. So, you know, Paul was warning the Colossians not to let anybody judge them when it comes to rituals like the new moons and even Sabbath days, because those were all associated with the law. Now, look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. And, you know, John is a prisoner. He's on the Isle of Patmos, and he says he's there. You know, he was, he was put there because of his faith in Christ and his aggressive evangelism for the Lord. And he said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. Praise the Lord. The Lord's day. Amen. How many of you know we're living in the Lord's day? Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Numbers chapter 15, verses 32 through 36. Numbers 15, 32 through 36. And we know that the reason Paul is saying this is because obviously at the time that Paul wrote this, there was no New Testament. They were all living by the Old Testament. That was where they got their scriptures from. His revelation of Jesus Christ came not only from angelic beings and from the Lord himself, but it actually came from the Word of God. Amen? The Old Testament was full of it, and that's where Paul got his revelation of Jesus. And so he saw by revelation, by the impartation of the Spirit, how that everything in the Old Testament was pointing to Jesus. And that's what he's talking about here. Let's not get confused with rituals. Let's not confuse rituals with Jesus. We've got the real thing. It's like a lot of people today, and I don't mean this to be ugly or anything, but you know, there are a lot of Christians today that have embraced this the Jewish rituals, traditions. You know, the prayer shawls and the menorahs. I've got a menorah at home. I had a prayer shawl. I gave it to a lady here in this church because it really meant something to her. To me, it was a type. It was a symbol of something of the Lord. But I mean, I didn't need it to pray. I prayed for a long time without it. And I'm praying now without it too. But I understand, you know, the symbolism there.
Right.
There's a lot of people, we've had some that wanted to use the church to have a Passover celebration. And although I'm not against a Passover celebration, I mean, Jesus has fulfilled all of these feasts. And we should be celebrating Jesus, not going backwards and trying to recapture something that has already been completed, that has been fulfilled. So that's what Paul was really talking about. Because here's where this all comes from. While the children of Israel were in the wilderness, they found a man that gathered sticks upon the Sabbath day. And they that found him gathering sticks brought him unto Moses and Aaron and unto all the congregation. And they put him in ward, or they locked him up, because it was not declared what should be done to him. And the Lord said unto Moses, the man shall be surely put to death. All the congregation shall stone him with stones without the camp. And all the congregation brought him without the camp and stoned him with stones, and he died as the Lord commanded Moses. So I think you might want to rethink that whole Sabbath picture, praise the Lord, because it was a day of rest. That was the purpose. That was the symbolism. We come to Jesus, and it's by his grace we're saved, not of works, lest any man should boast. He is the Lord of the Sabbath. Amen? He is the fulfillment of all of that. Because Israel's observance of the seventh day was more than a spiritual practice. It was a covenant sign. That's why it was so important to God. It was a sign of their relationship with God Almighty, with God's promises to them and their commitment to God. Amen? Look at Exodus chapter 31 and verse 17. So we see that, I want us to see the, you know, the types and the shadows and how these play out in our relationship with Jesus. So he said it's a sign, the Sabbath. It's a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in the 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. So it was a sign of their covenant. Jesus is the fulfillment of the covenant.
Yes.
Our confidence in him keeps us in covenant with God. It keeps the promises of God, amen, flowing to us. It was a witness to their identity as God's chosen people.
Amen.
Amen. Our relationship with Jesus, being in Christ, is the evidence of our relationship with God Almighty. Amen. With our being one with God. Amen. So what should we make of this today then? In the institution of the Sabbath, you have to realize there was a justification for economic restoration, for economic restructuring. The poor were made rich and so forth. There was redistribution of wealth and restoration of all things.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Look at Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28. And this is Jesus talking to these Jewish people, trying to get them that have been working and going, using the law and doing everything that they could to justify themselves and laboring all the time. And come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. He's the true rest. That one day out of the week was a rest, but it was a rest, amen, that was a sign of their relationship with God. It was a sign of the covenant. It wasn't literal. It was literal for them because the fulfillment hadn't come. But Jesus has come. He is our rest. And the Sabbath is 7 days a week for us.
Right.
There's even Christians today that still argue about, is it the last day of the week or the first day of the week? Is it Saturday? Is it Sunday? Hey, we choose to worship the Lord on Sunday. We're here on Wednesday night. But we really, from our hearts, we worship God every day. I hope we all do anyway. I mean, I hope that we realize He is our Sabbath.
Yes.
We have Him. We have a continuous, ongoing Sabbath. Praise the Lord. We have a rest that is 24/7, 365 days a year. Amen? The Old Testament observance of the Sabbath under the law of Moses was an obligation. It was a law. You had to keep it, or we saw what the consequences were. But they were looking forward to Christ. They were looking forward to something that was not yet. We, on the other hand, look to the promise that's fulfilled now. Amen? All of those things, if you think about Deuteronomy, where God says, if you do this, 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 and this, and this, this will be your blessing. This will be what you get as a result, healing and prosperity and all of these things. You'll be the head and not the tail. You'll be blessed coming in. You'll be blessed going out. You'll be blessed in the field. You'll be blessed in the stall. All of these blessings. Well, Jesus fulfilled the law.
Yes.
He kept all of the demands of Deuteronomy, and now we have the benefit of that. So we're looking back at those promises received.
Thank you, Lord.
That's why in the New Testament and under the Old Testament, He says, by whose stripes you are healed. In the New Testament, looking back to that, the apostles say, by His stripes you were healed.
Yes.
It's an accomplished thing. It's already finished. Praise the Lord. So, amen. Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 through 18. Colossians 2, 16 through 18. See, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of holy day or of the new moon or the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come. But the body is of Christ. Now look at this. Let no man beguile you or cheat you or deceive you out of your reward in voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his own fleshly mind. So don't be cheated out of your reward. Don't be cheated out of your inheritance, amen, by being sucked into these things that we do, thinking that they're going to satisfy something that Jesus hasn't already done for us. Amen? Jesus is the reality of everything that the biblical Sabbath represented. Praise the Lord. So, here's the point. Rest is more than a spiritual discipline. And the Sabbath is more than a day.
Yes.
Rest is a person.
Yes.
And we have that in Christ. We are to labor to enter in to that rest. That's the only work we're supposed to be doing, is to come in to Christ, into the rest of Jesus. To trust in the finished work. To believe that it is finished. Amen? Hebrews chapter 4, verse 3 says this. He's talking to the Jewish people. That's obviously, that's what the book of Hebrews is about, written to the Hebrew people. For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said. He's speaking about their history, amen, when they refused or failed to go into the promised land. So he says, we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. Can you see the picture of us here in this same thing?
Yes.
The work's done. Healings have been produced. I mean, the right for healing has already taken place. By His stripes, you were healed. We are already prospered. He became poor that we might become rich. He humbled himself so that we might be elevated, lifted up to the presence of God. He came down to earth so that we could come up to the throne of God. Amen? So who shall live? Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. So the Sabbath is both a location and it's a state of being. So by believing in Jesus, we relocate. We enter into a rest that's not allowed to those who would not enter into Canaan, who would not believe God. It's what Tim was talking about earlier.
Yes.
The only way you can receive from God is by believing God.
Yes, Lord.
Amen? If you believe God, you can rest in the finished work. You can rest in what God's done.
Yes.
Amen? If you trust God, you can rest. Amen? So they couldn't enter into Canaan, and it changed their state of being and their location. They didn't get the houses that they didn't build, right? The ones who didn't really go in. For 40 more years, they spent in the wilderness till they all died. They didn't obtain the promise of God. The vineyards they didn't plant. Amen? All the blessings, the victories, so on and so forth. So it changed their state of being. It changed their location. And those in Christ are at rest, and we have ceased from our own works. Praise the Lord. We have the promises of God, but we didn't do anything for it other than to believe God. Didn't the angel of the Lord tell Joshua, I'll go before you? Or he said, are you for us or against us? He said, I am the angel of the Lord. I've come. I'm going to go before you. You just have to show up.
Yeah.
I'll win the battle. I'll fight the battle for you if you'll just have faith enough to go, to change your location and enter in to the promise. All right? Verse 10, chapter 4, verse 10, Hebrews. For he that has entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works as God did from his. So there's a dual condition in Christ, at rest and in motion. Praise the Lord. You think about walking with Christ. I mentioned it earlier. You know, the tendency is to get ahead of God when we know that we're to follow God. But most humans are impatient. We're in a hurry. We want it now. Whatever it is, God's promises, we want it now. Actually, we wanted it yesterday or last week or sometime. But it's imperative that we learn to rest in the promise, not to get in a hurry, but to be led by God, to follow God rather than try to get ahead of God and create bigger problems. Amen? Think about, I know Tim has said this before, but just an example. People rush off and marry somebody. They didn't pray about it. Well, they're going to do a lot of praying afterwards, probably. Amen, right? Because I'm not talking about my life now. Praise the Lord, I got a good wife. Hallelujah, God's good. But I'm saying we make decisions and then we have to pray and pray and pray because we got ourselves into something that God really had not ordained for us or planned for us. Now, does that mean that it can't work out? Of course it can. But it means a lot more difficulty than it would have been if you had just waited on the Lord in the first place. That's true of jobs. I mean, how many of us, I know I have, I've taken jobs just because I wanted a job. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
And then I end up having three jobs before I get the job that I should have had if I had just waited and trusted God and waited on the Lord, right?
Right.
So it happens in all areas of life. So at the same time we are at rest, we're also in motion. We've entered into a state of rest by turning from our own effort to rely on the finished work of Jesus. At the same time, we are en route to the fulfillment of the kingdom promises. Does that make any sense at all?
Yes.
So we're still, this is the laboring to enter in. We walk with the Lord. We trust God. We are led by the Spirit. So we're resting, but at the same time, we're entering, we're moving. Amen. So rest is not necessarily mean that you're idle. It just means that you're trusting in what has already been accomplished. You're moving, but you're moving into the promises of God, into the completed works of God himself, by trusting in him and that they have been done, that they are complete. Amen? So rest is ultimately a person. And Jesus calls us to enter into his kingdom of rest. Amen? When Israel failed to enter into Canaan with Moses, they panicked because they heard about the power of these peoples who populated the land that God had promised them, the giants. Amen? And so the task seemed too much, exactly what Tim was talking about earlier. You know, God says go, and we say, whoa, wait a minute, I'm not equipped for this. You know, we're not trained for battle. We don't have the weapons. We don't have the armor. We don't have this. We don't have that. We don't have the education. Whatever it might be, we start making excuses. And even now, some people are looking for Moses to lead them out and into the promise. But that we're talking about is law. That we're talking about is human effort. And that's what God was showing them, a type of his having completed everything. If you'll trust me, if you'll trust me, you can go. Don't care what it looks like. Forget about what it looks like. I've already told you I'm going to give you the victory if you'll just trust me, if you'll just go.
Amen.
Amen. So we're resting, but we're moving at the same time. We're resting, but we're entering in. Amen. Matthew 11, verse 28 through 30. Again, this is where Jesus says, come unto me, all that you that labor. But I want you to notice something here beyond that. So Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Look at it again. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So Jesus, he isn't calling us to leave our comfort zone. He's calling us into our comfort zone. We just don't know it.
Yeah.
Amen? You can get used to stuff that isn't comfortable. Amen? You can get used to, you know, lifestyles and behaviors and ways of doing things that they're not necessarily comfortable, that you're just used to it. And he's saying, look, I'm trying to bring you into what is really rest. And I'm trying to get you into what you were created for, your real comfort zone, your true identity. And the rest that Jesus offers, it can be taken, but it can't be seized by force.
Right.
You can't get it by your own effort. You can only get it by receiving it, by accepting what God has done. So we don't manage ourselves into it. Or we don't get it by bargaining, or we don't get it by discipline. Rest, the way that Jesus describes it, has to be done for you. Jesus is the subject of the verb here in Matthew 11, 28. We are the object, all ye that labor, heavy laden. I give you rest. Amen? I will rest you. What Jesus says could be translated that way. I'll rest you. I'll refresh you. God's rest is the rest of completion, the rest of fulfillment, the rest of his presence.
Yes.
Amen? Give the Lord a hand clap. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. So let's labor to enter into his rest. Let's get yoked up with Jesus. Walk this walk with him and see how God unfolds your destiny before your very eyes.
Amen.
Amen? It's never too late. The promises of God are still yea and in him, amen. Praise the Lord. They must come to pass, even as he has declared. Amen. All right, God bless all of you. Thank you for your patience, for being here tonight. Have a great rest of your week, and we hope to see you back here Sunday. The Lord bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.